ladies and gentlemen of the interwebs. I'm Jason from Bucketlist, and I'm doing today with Cory Putman, normal motherfucking Gene.
Yeah, good, man. Doing awesome.
Yeah. All right, so I'm just going to run through a couple of questions. Obvious shit. How's the tour going so far?
Only like 3 days in, so yeah. 1 day. First Canadian show, and this is the first Canadian tour that we've done since 2010. So
yeah.
We're looking forward to it. All the shows are great. Neither's is rules. It's a really good package. Really good.
Yeah, check it out.
Great lineup.
Yeah. Although you guys don't come up here a lot, I notice you guys are really busy. Shit. What do you feel, especially as a singer, do you keep yourself busy?
I'm inspired to do what we do, you know, based on family, and, you know, just, that's kind of like a push for me to, like, do this as hard as I can, as long as it's not really in there, you know, I want to be able to, you know, make this worth it, and not just be like when I was 17, you know, 18 to 20 doing this and just keep it off. You know, we still have a blast, but put a lot more into it now than we ever did when we were younger. So I think we're the best we've ever been.
Yeah, there you go. I'm noticing particularly on this run, you guys are mostly doing a lot of smaller venues, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
Is there something in particular that caused that?
Or it's like, just
you
better.
Just wanted to do like a more of an intimate kind of thing?
Our fans are older, so like, it's kind of, we've noticed that fans being older want to drink, and you know, so all the shows aren't doing as well,
yeah.
Honestly. So we play more, you know, the show's better, the overhead is a lot lower, so there's more chance for us to all make more money and be able to pay the bills. It just works out, it's in an intimate setting, so it's fun. And you know, by the time we get on the stage, everyone's plastic. So that's entertaining. That's entertaining on its own, just for us to watch them get drunk. But it's just we started doing it about March 2015. Shows like that, and we just noticed that we did better. More people wanted to come. More people did come, and we. And at the end of the day, we were all really happy with it. And well, also too, it allows us to play to saturate more like a state, like Florida, for instance. We can play like 6 or 7 different cities instead of just 2. Because you know, the radius clause in like House of Blues, for instance, that you can't play anywhere else, pretty much. You know, we can hit everywhere and pack all those places out. Pretty much a weekend set. There's just so many different pluses.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I was there for the summer song last time.
Yeah,
that was absolutely. No, this is a side prod. One particular comment you made is that you applied to earlier in the recording or any process. What particularly made you say that? Were there any particular things that happened, or was it just a cover?
It's been a long time. We wrote 2 years. We scrapped the record once. Once in the studio. So by the end of it, we were
focused. Your timeline comes around.
Yeah,
everybody's happy again.
We're just ready to be done. Now we're getting the writing bug back, so we're about to start writing. I don't know if we ever want to spend that much time in the studio again, but knowing us, I'm sure we will end up with that.
Yeah.
See what happens.
Hey man, if it works, don't fix it.
Yeah, that's right.
Speaking specifically about the record itself, obviously you guys have always had a bit of a knack for just fucking up everything. It's all just the most kind of shit when it comes to names or whatever it is. And this particular record, I know Hoops, there's a couple of things that stuck out that were a little weirder than usual. It's like After Hours, or the Pottermaster Pants. What? Do you just think of a name that randomly comes to your head and stick it on the song, or is there some topic that's
too? Yeah, there's always meaning, always something behind the titles. Sometimes the titles don't even really match the song, they just match the vibe of the song. The music, so we named it one thing, but it's about something completely different. After Hour Animals is actually a name of a project I was going to do, a solo project. I named it After Hour Animals because I'm a writer. So everything I do is leading up until 3, 4, 5 a.m. Then, sit until 11, 12, and then. Get up and stay up really late. I've always been like that since I was a kid. I've always been an insomniac, so that's where it comes from. Like, I'm not proud of that.
Speaking of our people,
Butter Has No Hands is from the Bible. I don't know the exact verse, what it is, but it's basically saying, like, the piece of butter doesn't question its maker. It knows it's been formed by something. It doesn't say, oh, the butter has no hands. So that's what that
is. Alright, cool. Now, moving on more towards some of the more promotional stuff you've done with this record. The last couple of records you've done, music videos and stuff like that, have been more eerie kind of things. Live to them, Lock Them Thicker, sort of sense. Whereas this record, you've got a dude in a shark outfit trying to become another guy, and then a party where everybody's puking out. Is there any sense of...
I think for us, like, videos, the video thing is totally different because that's just us having fun. We have stupid ideas on film because videos, there's no MTV anymore playing the videos. There's no Greenberg ball anymore and all that. It's just going to go online and you're going to try to get as many views as you can. So we're like, well, let's just make a really interesting video, maybe kind of weird. Or funny, and it's all to get people to listen to the song. It doesn't really relate to the song at all. we're really inspired by the Red Fang videos. They have the best videos in the world, so
just destroying mountains of paths for no good reason.
Yeah, just the best videos. And we're like, well, they're doing it right, so we need.
Influential in sound. Like I said before, you guys can see since just after the Red Round even came out and the way it's up now. And I noticed that in specifically versus the anti-bug, there was a little less of an impression on this at the records, and then somehow through Rondos, that's all kind of flipping back. Was there just something different about what you have with it, or was it just creative?
I think at that time. The answer is whether it's polymer, so we're still getting it over that. Because in our minds, that's the most aggressive thing.
Really?
Okay. I mean, obviously, robots breathing zero has kind of a pop appeal to it. But that was us, like, experimenting with melody for the first time. So that's what came out. Here at Meridian, you see that we finally found what we were looking for.
Yeah.
And then, as far as melody goes, we didn't quite know what we were doing.
Yeah.
But then, there's also on that record, there's like the Snakes and Actors, and there will be a Storm of Worlds. Death of the Antimatter is the episode. Those are all on that record. So to us, it's like, we were trying to experiment with sound and trying to break away. And so that's really what that record is. And not misunderstood, but for some people, some people love it, some people hate it. And to us, it's just like, well, we had to go through that.
Yeah, great record nonetheless.
That's all we don't know, like, how, we love it, but, it's, at the end of the day, we knew that that was something we had to do.
Well, the way I was looking at it, it was kind of the same progression that Saturday night. Flaring record with Diamond
See,
on.
Saturday Night Wrist is their misunderstood record, but that's exactly. a really good record.
Awesome record. Awesome songs on it.
It definitely very misunderstood. But I think the thing you have to realize too is like there's a lot, there's emotion that goes into these records. And that record is very, very dark times for us, specifically. I was going through the divorce. I didn't like myself. So that's what that record is. And listen to the, read the lyrics. They're brutal.
Oh, yeah.
They're very, very. They're the most, brutal lyrics I've ever written. On that record, that is the most lyrically, like, I guess, scary record, but, you know, they were really down the
depressed. Yeah, dude.
And that came through, you know, and that's what people hear, I think, that emotion gets to people, and it's weird, it weirds them out a little bit, I think, so, you know, if you're going to put that on the, you know, out there for everyone to hear, you're going to have to deal with the album.
Yeah, totally. In that ending of thinking about Robo Book Kevin was able to talk about collaborative work he did over the years. Specifically your voice on other records, their voices on your record. Anyone from the is that something that sparked just out of general interest from random musicians, or is this two things just saying screw it? What really makes your collective work?
We never want to bring someone in to do a guess what? Let's check it out. We always want to have them come in and write the song with us first. I think we learn more that way. Thing instead of just coming in and, well, here's the lyrics, just yell that over this. So that's what Chino did, that's what Adrian did. You know, Cove was a big part of the lyrics. Sat down with the lyrics together. So I think that is really what we go for is you know, trying to learn something from someone. We always felt like you're never like so good at something that you can't learn anything else. There's always more to learn, there's always more to do. And so that to us, music wise, is the best way to do it.
Well, another was that what happened when you sat down for Francis the last year? Did that whole thing come down to that, or did they just come in and say, hey,
we were on tour together.
Yeah.
And I just jumped in their van, they were on the way to the studio, and they were like, yeah, you were just vocals on the song. I was like, let's do it, you know? And I wrote the lyrics and the what I wanted it to do, and I was really sticking on the track, but it didn't come out. We just doubled it.
That's fine. That's surprising to hear, actually. Absolutely insane track. We're gonna wrap it up. Obviously, now that we've talked about the whole making friends thing for collaborative work, most controversial question you'll probably be asked. Try not to get freaked out by it.
All right. What do you want to do?
That'll be done. I don't even know what you said. I'm a big Redeemer fan myself, so far.
Well, you know, come up front and start yelling, dude.
Yeah, dude. Got it.
Just come on. Everyone's gonna be up there.
Oh yeah,
along,
I know. I'll have to. I'll probably have to.
Just
shove
join the club.
Right?
That's all I can say.
And this is the part where somebody gets a restraining order. Thank you for watching, fuckers.
<See ya. laughs>